Now, should you hinge cut on your land? First off, I want to say that hinge cutting is a viable tool in any competent deer manager's toolbox of tricks and things to do on your property. It is a good practice. But Dylan and I, we talk about this all the time. We recommend it to our clients. And we look at their overall timber stand, the type of habitat they have, the type of timber and habitat, and make recommendations on what they should do long term based on their goals, but wildlife goals, whitetail goals, and even timber production goals, and what is best practice for their property. So that can range greatly from one property to the other. But bottom line, it is a viable tool. And we talk about a lot that we probably recommend it on 10 to 20% of all parcels, and that's it. Dylan, would you say less or more? Or?
It's very situational. I would say, 10 to 20% is a pretty good
is range. The range.
Yeah, yeah.
And sometimes in a given year, it might be more 10, 15% than closer to 20. But I would say that would be overall. Again, it's a viable tool. It creates some controversy sometimes because there are certain foresters, loggers don't believe in it because they don't understand it or manage it or know how to use it. And that's unfortunate. We try not to make recommendations about things we don't understand, but people do all the time. What is it? You know, a hinge cut is you're taking that tree and you're cutting it horizontal to the ground, and then you're tipping that tree over so that it creates a hinge. Now, it's really important to talk about what height to do that at waist height. But the reason you're doing that is because it puts cover at deer level, at critter level, rabbits, grouse, whatever it might be, escape cover, holding cover, but then also puts browse. So you see online that, you know, hinge cutting, you have to hinge cut for a deer bed, and that couldn't be further from the truth. You know, back in the olden days, people believed that deer would go under these hinges, and that's what you needed for actual bedding cover, when really they're just creating, going out in open woods and making this cover, and if they're going to bed anywhere, it's going to be there because there's cut timber, and it actually creates a little bit of side cover. That's why when you have these open bedding canopies that are 6 feet high, look at this, think trampoline, this deer will bed right here in this location, but they can see this way and all around a lot of times in 150 yards in open timber. So because there's no really side cover, it's just that ceiling cover, that canopy, then back in the old days, people put logs in there that deer would back up against. And that was because it was a deficient bedding area. They didn't have that side cover, so that's where the logs come in. So it's actually making a deficient bedding area, and then adding that log because it's deficient to try to make it better. And kind of see how this works. Hinge cut is not a bedding area. A bed, meaning you're making a canopy and making a bed. It creates a bedding area. There's a big difference. You're putting, obviously, if you put side cover down, side cover is the term that I use and came up with to refer to cover from side to side, cover that keeps deer from seeing each other, deer from seeing you, you seeing deer. It creates a higher sense of security. If you have too much side cover in predation areas, areas where deer are used to big wilderness and big woods, they'll avoid those areas because they get tunneled, they get really confined in those areas, and it's too compartmentalized for them. So they don't like that. A predator can pounce on them. They can't see predators coming, and wild dogs can push into them. But bottom line is you want side cover, and then that side cover creates growth and regeneration along that tree that deer can eat. So that's the purpose of a hinge cut. It has to have sunlight hitting it, because if it doesn't, we see hinge cuts all the time where someone will pay someone to come out and make a hinge cut bedding area for them, and it's under the shade canopy. They only wanted to cut the smaller trees. They don't want to touch the bigger trees. Well, someone you're paying $4,000 a day to come out and cut, happily going to come cut for you. And they might not even know they don't come back, but those trees die because they're under shade. So you took trees that were 30, 40 feet tall. They're skinny. They're getting a little bit of sunlight. They're surviving. Now you hinge cut them down to the forest floor. They're getting complete shade and they die. And that's something we see common. So the reason why you're doing this, again, is side cover and browse. Always think about that. That's why we cut waist high, not head high. Not to mention, not a very smart thing to put your chainsaw at face level and cut, not smart in any way. Height, you know, again, waist high. We don't do this too low because now the deer can see over it. We don't do it too high because it's unsafe and deer can see under it, and it puts brows above their head, which is the opposite of what you're trying to accomplish. Size of the tree, typically anywhere from 2 to 6 inches. We'll call the height waist high, 2 to 6 in diameter for the size of the tree. So it doesn't matter how tall it is. If it fits in there, it's pretty easy to manipulate and push that over the direction you want to go and also get a good cut on. Now, we strongly encourage you to use a tool like the Habitat Hook, Nick Nation. We're not sponsored by them. It's just the best tool for making hinge cuts. It's solid steel. I really like the rectangular ones that are telescoping, a little bit more rigid, but really you're pushing most of the time. It's got a T-handle. People think you're hooking, you know, pulling it down, but you're actually pushing. So you have a buddy pushing that over and then someone's cutting. So what that does is allows you to cut through the tree only about halfway before you get to that to push over, even a 6-inch diameter tree. You can control which way it goes very easy, so you're not making a big mess. And at the same time, you can get trees down through other trees and pole timber a lot easier because you don't have to rely on it falling naturally the way it was going to fall in the first place or guesstimating where it's going to go. So you can telescope that out. I usually use it on the middle setting, but a very good tool to be able to do that with. The variety of tree, oak, hickory, ash, red maple is awesome, box elder. Box elder, a lot of times you can hinge, you know which way it's going to go. A lot of these, you know, you don't hinge cut, and we've seen this on properties, but you don't hinge cut conifer, you don't hinge cut aspen. Aspen regenerates out the stump, or out the root system, not the stump like hardwoods do. So usually like cherry is very brittle, it's hard to get to hinge cut. A lot of these hinge cut better when the sap's actually flowing in the spring before leaf out, or late summer is a great time to do so too. Winter time's okay to do so, but you really want to avoid those prolonged cold periods, because even something like a red maple that has a lot of resiliency to it and it'll actually almost stretch and be very limber when the sap's flowing, that sap will almost crystallize and shatter when you try to hinge cut that during the dead of winter. So you want some warm days, you want that sap flowing to make sure it's cutting. And heck, some of you don't have to worry about those warm days. You're down in southern Ohio or Kentucky or West Virginia cutting, and you don't have to worry about it because you don't get those deep freezes like we do up here in the north. But it's a real concern if you do have those 15, 20 degree nights, it's only getting up to 30 during the day, you're going to really have a lot of crystallized sap within that tree, and it's going to shatter when you try to push it over. So some of those varieties, though, that work really well, that red maple, box elder, those are excellent. Hickory, the browse isn't that preferred by deer, but they're very easy to manipulate and hinge cut. Great side sprouters. That's another really good one, too. So now, number 6, do you need logging? Because we go to a lot of properties that just expect that we're going to recommend they need to hinge cut when 90% of their bedding work can be taken care of by a logging operation. They need someone to come in and log for them. So why lift a chainsaw? Well, especially till after the logging takes place, but why lift a chainsaw if you can have someone else do all that work for you? You got a lot of other things to do. Hunter access routes, maybe switchgrass plantings, food plots, stand locations, blind locations, maintenance, water holes, mock scrapes, camera locations. There's a lot of other things to do that are higher priority than making hinge cuts. But some people, you have that perfect diameter tree, a lot of pole timber. You don't have that overhead canopy of mature trees. It's a younger forest. You have that perfect variety of red maple, maybe even hickory or ash, maybe some type of oak, trees that actually hinge cut well, non-conifer, non-aspen. And that's your option. That's all you have. So you have to consider that, you know, that's your last resort, not your first. And unfortunately, we see certain habitat managers that they go out to a property 90% of the time, they're hinge cutting, even large trees. And that's not what you want to do. You want to get that large canopy down first. You want to clean that up so the deer can move around it a little bit on an overall timber production. Even a higher priority than hinge cutting would be you have those tops down on the ground of hardwoods. They're disconnected because it's been logged. So all those logs are taken out. You have that top in there. Great time to stab 5 or 6 conifers into that, white pine, white spruce that are shade tolerant. Stab those into that top so that the deer can't browse them. That's a great way to diversify your forest for years to come and decades and century or more to come, as opposed to hinge cutting. But hinge cutting is that last that last step sometimes that'll produce that last 5-10%. But if you have a lot of tops on the ground, you're getting great hardwood regeneration. You might even have an aspen mixed in or boxed elder. Those are all very prolific sprouters, great for regeneration after harvest, and you might not need to hinge cut at all. So we look at that as one of the last things you do. Timber harvest we look at is always first. The second would be cutting down large, mature, non-timber species of trees, say red maple down at the bottom where you have multi-trunked, twisted trunks of oaks, leaners of oaks that you're cutting down. You want to get that regeneration. Those would always come first because you can get down a lot of canopy trees and they make a big difference, get a lot of sunlight to the ground. And then maybe you hinge cut at the end to support those trees that you cut down, offer some side cover, additional sprouting, and that's when you'd hinge cut. So again, it's a tool. I think Dylan, you had a couple of people on this last trip. They questioned, how come you didn't recommend?
I think because of the videos, we get kind of lumped into this, you know, the toolbox that you mentioned earlier, and everybody thinks they got to use every tool in that box, no matter what they're doing on their property. So I had some clients last week that were just almost disappointed that I didn't assign them this big hefty task of going and doing a bunch of hinge cutting. So
it was yeah. Funny. And I think they're ready to sometimes, no different than Dylan pointed out too, that, you know, we're a huge proponent of switchgrass. I sell switchgrass, but I had to tell several clients out of five in Ohio recently that there's no reason for you to plant switchgrass. You know, it's in the woods. You're going to get shaded out. You already have good cover along the food plots with shrubs and grasses and briars and hardwood regeneration growing. Why plant the switchgrass? When you get up north into predation areas, you have small food plots. You don't want to line those small little 8-acre hunting plots with switchgrass because now the deer can't see out. They can't see in. They can't see predators coming. So we notice that predator effect when you get north. So even though we're huge proponents of switchgrass, it doesn't mean we use it on every property or recommend it, even though I sell it. And it's the same with hinge cuts. Even though it's a tool in the toolbox, we always say it's a viable tool. That doesn't mean we recommend it on more than 20% of all properties all the time. So I hope you understand hinge cutting a little bit better. I wanted to explain some of the basics here a little bit. We'll hinge cut. We'll show some hinge cuts. We're going to be probably likely tomorrow. We had my big shooter buck show up in Wisconsin this morning coming into a bedding area. Dylan and I are going to go in this afternoon and hopefully catch him coming back out of that bedding area. And we'll see about that. But I'm kind of excited to get in there. That tag goes through the 31st. I think I have about three more sits with that tag this year. And I'm specifically going after that buck. But tomorrow we'll get out in the woods and we'll show some of the hinge cuts from last year and what they look like. And so Dylan will probably insert that B-roll into this video. So hope that makes sense to you. Really explore all the options of every habitat improvement. You know, people recommend burning. Burning is a great middle of the country type thing in your hardwoods where you can get green herbaceous growth because of the climate that's available all the way into January, February. But that herbaceous growth that you'd create from burning up north is gone by the time the hunting season comes around. And during the summertime, the deer have an overabundance of green herbaceous growth. So really know there's certain things that are viable tools some places and not others. When you understand why you don't use a habitat tool, even though you do other places, that's when you actually learn. And we're trying to bring that experience level to you so you can understand how to use, and most importantly, if you should use hinge cuts this year. Hey, I'm really excited to introduce to you our Hills and Thermals web class. It's something we worked on all year. We're trying to put lots of facets of scouting, aerial imagery, diagrams on the whiteboard to really teach you how the wind moves through hills and how you should find bedding areas, how it relates to deer movements in general, how that relates to, this is a bedding area stand, this is a food source afternoon stand. We really tried to put this together and offer you a complete picture of how to navigate hills and find better success consistently where you hunt.